Make us to be more like Jesus, for we do pray in his name. Amen.
I'm going to ramp it down just a hair from where we practiced it, just so you know, so we can get all the words in. I want to take a minute on behalf of the family to thank you all, for those of you who are in the loop through Facebook or some other way of connection with us, for praying with us and praying for us and supporting us. My left-hand woman is absent this morning because she's at Children's Hospital and recovering from a cesarean section. Jack was born Friday in the afternoon, came in at a whopping 2 pounds, 5 ounces. And it's a humbling thing to walk into a NIC unit and to behold your grandson and to take in all that was going on in those moments and to see the love in my daughter's eyes. And it's a wondrous time, but it's a difficult time as well. I told John, for me especially, and I'm coming clean to everybody in the group this morning, I've always been a tough guy. I've always been the guy who can fix something. You bring it to me, I'll give it my best shot, and usually I'll work it out. I walked in this morning and a stupid sign for the visitors was dangling, and I found all the stuff laying on the ground, and I fixed it. It's what I do. But as I stood there looking at Jack, I realized I can't fix this. I can't make things go back. I can't correct the things that went wrong as they did in accordance with what we believe are the purposes and the plans of God. I just thank him for his goodness and his protection, that there were good people in place who helped save my daughter's life, literally, and who saved my grandson. And they're still working on it. So we're grateful for that. Beck should be home tomorrow, and let's keep her in prayer, please, as some adjustments I know are going to be hard for her. But let's worship the Lord together. Yeah, let's start the right chords.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of his servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, preparing the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
Grab hold of the program this morning, if we will, please, and reach inside, and please take the connection card that you find there. And grab one of those purple pens. We're going to take the next couple moments to fill these out together. And then please keep the card nearby. We're going to come back to it near the end of worship, as we do every week. And we're all going to be encouraged to take at least one next step in our spiritual journeys. And some possible next steps are outlined on the back of the card. So let's take the next couple of moments, please, to fill these out.
This particular song is, again, one of those rattled around through my head songs. And I've been playing this song for 40 years and have enjoyed it every time I've played it. Jerry Jeff Walker is the name associated with it, but more particularly for some of us, maybe the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band, and definitely Sammy Davis Jr., Mr. Bojangles. Probably the best I've ever played it.
You found an envelope in your program as well. I encourage you to use that if you'd like to make a financial donation to support God's work through Open Arms, or if you'd still like to make a donation towards freedom, just put that on your envelope so that we know how you would like to give that. Tuesday evening, the men's only group is meeting here at the church. We invite you guys to check it on out. We're continuing a study of the life of Moses and the leadership qualities and what difference that can make in our lives. It's still not too late to grab a packet for our annual Christmas chocolate sale. If you have questions, Laura's contact information is there, especially since this year you can just do your ordering right online rather than bringing things to the church. So if you have questions or comments, please contact Laura. If you have trouble getting a hold of her, give me a call as well. We have the Light and Life magazines for October. I invite you to grab it. I've read all of it this week, except for the Spanish part. But I read all the English. Really interesting stuff about the end times, the return of Jesus, and so forth. Especially if you're a Lord of the Rings fan, you might find some things that are interesting there. And then you see in the announcement there that we need to replenish the snacks and beverages that help to welcome people here to Open Arms. So thank you for your continuing generosity. Let's stand together then as we sing, please.
Before the world was made, before you spoke it to be, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were, yeah, you were. And now your reign is still enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out. We join them as we sing. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Creator God, you gave me breath so I could praise your great and matchless name all my days. So let my whole life be a blazing offering, a life that shouts and sings the greatness of our King. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever.
Take my life.
Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in His city. Greater things are yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in His city. You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of these people. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come. Greater things are still to be done here.
I invite you to be seated. Indeed, Lord, you are the God over all things. You are the God over all things, whether or not we acknowledge that you are the God over all things. Your reign, your rule, your authority, not dependent on our recognition of who you are, but it is certainly in our best interest to recognize the truth of who you are and for us to bend the knee of our lives before you and to accept you as our Savior and as our Lord. Under your authority, under your care, Lord, wondrous things happen in our lives.
Amen.
Not always the way we expect them or ask for them or how you work in someone else's life, because you individualize your mercy and care for each and every one of us. And you reveal yourself as a God who loves us in very personal ways. Lord, we need you to do that in our lives. We need you to help us to see how you have been at work in our lives and how you are revealing yourself even in today's circumstances, and how we can have hope and trust in you for the future. Indeed, Lord, I look at my own spiritual journey and I recognize the great things, the miraculous things that you've done, but yet there are greater things yet to come. For me, for all of us, Lord. So So help us to say yes to Jesus and to allow you to do whatever it is that you want to do in and through our lives. It has been a week for many of us, filled up with all sorts of things, plenty of things that remind us that indeed we cannot fix everything, but you can. So we lay our lives before you, Lord, and the lives of those that we care about, and all of the problems, the issues, the difficulties, the trials and tribulations, whatever it is, Lord, we lay them before you as well as an act of worship and simply request that you would work as you see fit. We pray in the name of Jesus.
Friday was my birthday. I'm 65 years old. I'm an old, old man. And I got quite the birthday present Friday. And I will never forget my grandson's birthday. Never forget Andy's birthday either.
Yeah, Andy.
Let's continue to worship the Lord.
When I lose my way and I forget my name, remind me who I am. In the mirror, all I see is who I don't want to be. Remind me who I am. In the loneliest places, when I can't remember what grace is, tell me once again who I am to you, who I am. Tell me, lest I forget who I am to you, that I belong to you, to you. When my heart is like a stone and I'm running far from home, remind me who I am. When I can't receive your love, afraid I'll never be enough, remind me who I am. If I'm your beloved, can you help me believe it? Tell me once again who I am to you, who I am to you. Tell me, lest I forget who I am to you, that I belong to you, to you. I'm the one you love. I'm the one you love. That will be enough. I'm the one you love. Tell me once again who I am. I am. belong to you. To you. To you.
Grab hold of that program once again, if you would please. And if you want to do the fill in the blanks, I invite you to grab hold of that purple pen. Follow along. We're going to look at Psalm 81 today. And we have one word kind of description for the message today. And that word is if. If. Now I have the definition, grammar definition here, that if is a conjunction that introduces a conditional clause. Anybody remember Saturday morning cartoon? And what is that? Conjunction, junction, what's your function, right? Something like that, wasn't it? What was the name of that? It's, yes! Let the teacher toss it out there. Schoolhouse Rock. If. Conditional clause. If we wonder what those are, remember the Wizard of Oz. Remember the Scarecrow from the Wizard of Oz. And what did he say? If I only had a brain, then he could think great thoughts. Wasn't that it? As he stood there and the wizard was going to help him to think, gave him the diploma, and all of a sudden he was a brilliant scarecrow. If calls people to make choices. Growing up, how many of us heard, if you want to have dessert, then you must what? Yeah, clean your plate, finish your dinner first, whatever kind of stuff. So you had to make a choice. Am I going to finish what's on my plate right here and then have dessert, or am I going to forget dessert? We got to make the choice. If, very small word, huge importance. Now, Psalm 81 is an ancient poem to God's people from time past. But it has much truth for us today as well. In fact, all of God's Bible has truth for us in all things in our lives. First thing we find from Psalm 81 is this, that we are called to praise the Lord for his past goodness. To praise the Lord for his past goodness. Let me read the first seven verses of Psalm 81, and I invite you to follow along, please. Sing for joy to God our strength. Shout aloud to the God of Jacob. Begin the music. Strike the timbrel. Play the melodious harp and lyre. Sound the ram's horn at the new moon. And when the moon is full. Last night, did you see how big the moon was? Oh man, it was amazing, wasn't it? On the day of our festival. This is a decree for Israel, an ordinance for the God of Jacob. When God went out against Egypt, he established it as a statute for Joseph. I heard an unknown voice say, I removed the burden from your shoulders. Their hands were set free from the basket. In your distress, you called, and I rescued you. I answered you out of the thundercloud. I tested you at the waters of Meribah. Really recounts there how God miraculously released his people from Egyptian slavery. It reminds us here of how God had worked in his ancient people's lives in keeping the promises that were made to Joseph. You know, the one sold into slavery by his brothers, the one with the technicolor dream coat. Okay? Promises made almost 400 years before God showed up in the Exodus of having God's people return to the land of promise. What is the whole thing about Meribah? Meribah is that desert place where the people were saying to Moses, grumbling against him as they often did, that God had just brought them into the desert to have them be so parched that they would die of thirst. But what happened? God instructed Moses to stand before the people and to take the staff and to strike the rock. And water came from the rock, and all of the people, and the animals, and there was more water than they knew what to do with. based on what God had done to form this nation in the Exodus event and all of the things that happened surrounding the Exodus. God called on the people to praise him because of his past goodness. Friends, what has Jesus done for us already? I mean, sometimes when I'm in that kind of grumpy mood or, you know, it seems like I'm feeling down, I try to remind myself. Sometimes it takes the spiritual 2x4, however, to remind myself that God has done wondrous things in my life and in your life as well. And to recall those things, what Jesus has done, can help bring us through a difficult time. Really, what has Jesus done for us already? I put in the program there, forgiveness of sin. I mean, that's a no-brainer. No-brainer. The Scarecrow. Wizard of Oz. Huh, hadn't thought of that. We've all sinned. We've all removed ourselves from God's presence, and there's nothing we can do to earn our way into God's heaven, so to speak. He's done it all already for each and every one of us. What has Jesus done for us already? He makes the offer of forgiveness for each and every one of us, no matter who we've been, no matter what we've done, no matter what we're doing right now. He loves us and wants to forgive us and restore us and to bring us back into the presence of the God who loves us, not just down the road in glory for all of eternity, but right here and right now where eternity begins. What else has he done for us? If we went around the room, Nell answered over here, we could go around and we could all come up with, looking back, what God has done for us in Christ Jesus. And then I like how the psalm begins, sing for joy to God, our strength. Is not Jesus our strength in the midst of all the things that we face? When we do realize that there's plenty of life we cannot deal with on our own. In fact, you've heard me say it before, we were never intended to deal with any of life on our own. Because he is our strength. He is the one who made us, who loves us, who gave himself for each and every one of us. So we're called to begin with praise for the Lord's past goodness. What's the next thing we find from Psalm 81 is this, that we are called to remember past disobedience. And for people like me, perhaps it's present disobedience. The Lord declared, "Hear me, my people, and I will warn you. If you would only listen to me, Israel." Can you hear the heart of God there? If you would only listen to me. We're going to discover he says the same thing to us. "You shall have no foreign god among you. You shall not worship any god other than me. I am the Lord your God who brought you up out of Egypt. Open wide your mouth and I will fill it." But my people would not listen to me. Israel would not submit to me. So I gave them over to their stubborn hearts to follow their own devices. Unfortunately, that was too much of the history of ancient Israel. Kind of a roller coaster ride, if you will, of following after the Lord God, then getting complacent, kind of starting to downward, getting to the bottom where they have turned their back on God. Judgment would come upon them because of that. And then they would finally start to look to God and kind of climb in the next hill, if you will, till they got to the point where they're in a right relationship with the Lord God. Maybe that roller coaster, unfortunately, describes some of our spiritual journeys as well. But here we find God's ancient people, those very people who had witnessed God's wondrous works in their own lives, and they turned their back on him. We mentioned the Exodus earlier as a foundational event for God's ancient people, and really the cause for praise to him. They saw the 10 plagues poured out on their Egyptian captors. They saw the parting of the Red Sea. They were led by the cloud of God's presence, by the fire of his presence by night. And yet, God says, if you'll just listen to me. This God who had done such wondrous things in their lives, and yet, what does it say here? They would not listen. They turned their backs on God. I'd like to think we would be different. But then I look back in my journey, and I'm not so different, unfortunately. I mean, we find in Exodus chapter 20 where Moses is receiving the Ten Commandments. He's up on the mountaintop. You know, the place is shaking and there's smoke and lightning bolts and all sorts of things. And the people down in the valley are quickly breaking the first of the Ten Commandments. While Moses is still in the presence of God. About having no gods before, no foreign gods. And what are the people doing? Giving Aaron the gold that they had in order that they could melt it down. And as he describes it to Moses later, when Moses comes down and he's pretty ticked off, "Well, I threw the gold in the fire and out came this golden calf." Liar. If you read the event, you discover that Aaron, yes, he threw the gold in the fire, but then he fashioned with a tool the golden calf. In experiencing God's goodness, his presence, his mercy, his provision, and yet they turn their back on him. The very thing God told them not to do, they did it anyway. Go back to the Garden of Eden. Don't eat from that tree. What did they do? Go to the Mount Sinai. Don't make any gods. Don't bow down to anyone else but me. And yet they do that. God speaks to us in our lives and says, do this, don't do that. How often do we kind of turn our backs on him as well? Friends, if we didn't know it before, maybe we've forgotten it. God does not speak to us in order for him to hear his own voice. Isn't that what parents say to kids? I'm not saying this to you for the umpteenth time because I need to remind myself of what you need to do, right? God doesn't speak for himself. He speaks for us to shape our lives. But what does God's people do? They would not submit to him. They would not listen to him. So he gave them over to their stubborn hearts to follow their own divine. Gave them over. If that's what you want to do, if that's how you want to live your life, here, do it. Friends, it's never good when God gives us over to our own devices. That's a sure recipe for disaster. It was for God's ancient people. It has been in my life and it has been in yours as well. Life will fall apart. We read it as well in Romans chapter 1, verse 28. We're in the darkness of our minds. God will let us go down those scary, destructive paths if that's what we want, in an effort to bring us back to him. But it's never good when God says, okay, do it your way. It's never going to work out. Friends, how have we chosen our way instead of listening to Jesus? From the past, maybe something we're wrestling with right now in our present lives, if you will. Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commands. True life is found only as we journey with Jesus. Anything else is a cheap imitation of life that God has for us. But in order for us to enjoy the life that's offered to us in Christ, we need to take responsibility for our waywardness from the God who loves us, and we need to repent. We need to make that 180-degree turn from where we're headed, no matter how good we think it is, and start to follow after him and allow him to have absolute sway over our lives, moment by moment and day by day. That leads us to the third part of the psalm. Psalm 81, we are called to respond obediently to the Lord now. We recognize his past goodness. We think about our past disobedience and the struggles we have perhaps even now in following after Christ Jesus. But then what are we going to do in a response to this God who will not give up on trying to draw us to himself? Here's what the Lord said. if my people would only listen to me, if Israel would only follow my ways. Again, truth for Israel, truth for us. How quickly I would subdue their enemies and turn my hand against their foes. Those who hate the Lord would cringe before him, and their punishment would last forever. But you would be fed with the finest of wheat. With honey from the rock, I would satisfy you. The Lord God gave his ancient people multiple choices to accept his authority, to accept his lordship over their lives, to allow him to be their God, to listen to him, to follow his decrees, his commandments. Gave them multiple choices. You can read the Old Testament. What do you find? The people turning away from God and God pursuing them in love and mercy, with forgiving love, wanting to draw them back to himself. We find that same thing in our lives as well. The Lord promised if the people would listen, if they would follow, he would take care of any enemies that were coming at Israel, and he would meet all of their needs, all of their needs. I put in bold print that idea, with honey from the rock I would satisfy you. We find that phrase in another place, in Deuteronomy chapter 32. In a passage from God's Bible known as the Song of Moses, where Moses, near the end of his life, praised God for the way in which he had miraculously provided for God's people over many years. From the exodus from slavery through the 40 years of wandering in the wilderness to coming to the borders of the land of promise where God was going to give that land to his people. Honey from the rock. I always picture water from the rock, right? But here, goodness, provision, abundant provision. Because honey's kind of an extra, isn't it? You need something else to go with it, don't you? Well, they're going to have the finest of wheat as well. Make some good bread. Put some nice honey on that thing. God was going to provide for all of their needs. I mentioned last week how oftentimes, too often really, I struggle with believing in God's provision for me, for my family, for you, for our church. One of those growing areas that still has got a lot of rough edges. But to believe that God would meet all of my needs, all of your needs, all of our needs together, what a wondrous promise given from the one who can keep that promise. I look at my own life and I consider what I know about you. And I see how Jesus continues to give us so many opportunities to journey with him, to come back to him, to remember, yes, his past goodness, to remember how we've disobeyed and wandered from him, how we might be in the wilderness right now, so to speak, and the hope that he gives us for the future, and how he constantly, continuously is drawing us to himself, to accept his lordship over our lives, so that he can provide for us in wondrous ways. To remind us that he's the Lord God, even if we don't recognize him as the Lord God. But it is in our best interest to recognize that he is our Savior and our Lord. And why? I put the bold print for the last fill in the blank for today. Compliance with Christ's commands. Notice the C's there. Had to go with them. Compliance with Christ's commands opens our lives to experience the fullness of God's love. God loves us no matter what. But if we're going to experience the fullness of the love and mercy he has for us in Christ Jesus, we must comply with Christ Jesus. We must yield to him. We must obey him. We must follow him. We must journey with him. We must allow him to recreate us in ways that he sees fit. And when he does that, as we show our love for him by keeping his commands, he then fills our lives with the very presence of God, with the very Spirit of God to be with us and within us moment by moment and day by day. And when we know that we are filled with the very presence of God, we know that he is taking care of us. No matter what. He is taking care of us. So grab your connection card, please. Because what might be a next step in our spiritual journeys that the Lord wants us to take today? Maybe you want to explore the truths from God's Bible, and you saw the page numbers corresponding to the passages we looked at today. They go to the Bibles that we have here. So grab one if you'd like, or grab one and give to a friend as they can begin reading God's Bible. Maybe we want to ask Jesus to show us how he's been at work in our lives already. Good step to take. Maybe we need to ask the Lord to reveal any sin in our lives and help us to seek his forgiving love. I want to take that step for sure today. And I always ask that you'll pray for me. As I'm praying for you in the next steps you're taking and the other requests that you're making. And then Wednesday night, thankfully, our prayer team will gather and we'll pray confidentially for all of us. Maybe our next step is to let Christ help us to listen to him and to follow him in obedience in every area of our lives. I'm also planning to be here next Sunday as we consider Psalm 91. Maybe Jesus has given you a special step that he wants you to take, and there's a blank line right there if you'd like to use it. In a couple of moments, Lori and Keith will be coming around with some baskets, and they'll be receiving the financial gifts we bring to support God's work through Open Arms. But most importantly, they're collecting our connection cards. So please, my friends, prayerfully take at least one next step in your spiritual journey. Then please place your connection card along with your giving in one of those baskets.
Took me from the pit I'd fallen in. Helped me back upon my feet again. Wiped the tears that were running down my face. Saved my dying soul from the grave. And he shows how he loves me more than I can see. And the empty grave gives hope today. Our dead is gone and we are changed. Why should I fear? For he is near and he found me where I was. That's my deliverer. That's my deliverer. Took me from the pit I'd fallen in. Helped me back upon my feet again. Wiped the tears that were running down my face. Saved my dying soul from the grave. And he shows how he loves me more than I can see. And the empty grave gives hope today. Our dead is gone and we are changed. Why should I fear? For he is near and he found me where I was. That's my deliverer. That's my deliverer. And the Savior King, his majesty, has risen for the world to see. The glory of his saving love, the glory of the Lamb. And the empty grave gives hope today. Our dead is gone and we are changed. Why should I fear? For he is near. And he found me where I was. And the empty grave gives hope today. Our dead is gone and we are changed. Why should I fear? For he is near. And he found me where I was. That's my my deliverer. That's my deliverer.
Let's see how the Lord Jesus is going to show up in our lives this coming week. Let's ask the Holy Spirit of God to kind of keep our eyes open and our ears unplugged and our hearts ready to receive what he's going to reveal to us about his great mercy that we all need. Remember this coming week that Jesus loves you. Remember, Jesus likes you. Remember that Jesus wants you, and that Jesus wants to hang out with you. So let him do it. And let's live life this coming week in the very presence of God. Thank you very much for choosing to be here today.
And the empty grave gives hope today. Our dead is gone and we are changed. Why should I fear? For he is near and he found me where I was. That's my deliverer. That's my deliverer.